have never been affiliated to the University of Bonn. So that's a formal part. So my talk is dedicated to control of ensembles of dynamical system, and it's a particular type of nonlinear system in infinite dimension. So the whole story is about trying to extend the algebraic approach, about what you have heard in the lectures in the in these days, and to promote this, to extend this to the infinite dimensional setting. So let me start. My first slides are perfectly known. I start with something different, not with ensemble control. That's just a history. I mean, how this topic of control and mixing, what was the beginning of this beautiful friendship, so to say. So it started with some question put by Sergei Kuksin, I believe, on the control of nonlinear partial differential equation, in particular on Navier-Stokes equation, and with degenerate control. So we have an infinite dimensional system, and we have a finite number of controls, of controlled modes, so to say, and we wish to study controllability, say, approximate controllability of such system, and to see, more important even was to see how the energy is transferred from mode to mode, what is the cascade, and the idea was to look for the algebraic structure into this transfer of energy along the modes. And so that was the idea of what we were used to in finite dimensional situation. And I repeat, the point is that we have a very limited number of controls. We always deal with so-called degenerate control, et cetera. So there were some, about 15 years ago, this work started, in these 15 years, there was a progress. I mean, several results obtained in this direction. The main method applied was the method of Lie extension, which has been mentioned along these days, also yesterday, for example, in context of stabilizability and stabilization. So the idea is that you can get of extended control system, so you can apply the algebraic approach and the extension in order to get extended control system and extended control, which are applied along the Lie brackets of the original, vector field. So that's the idea how you follow. That's the way to see the. How you follow the transfer of energy, how you see the cascade structure. So you look for the Lie brackets of some vector fields. And there was a plenty of results obtained in this and plenty of publications obtained in these 15 years. I repeat, that's just a historical introduction. The true story goes after. So the important thing also mentioned yesterday in the talk by Professor Zuev is that the important is the use of fast oscillating controls. So the controls which are fast oscillating in time. And another important notion also mentioned by several times in these days, a notion of solid controllability. So some kind of controllability which is structurally stable, so to say, stable under perturbances. So there was number of results obtained. So obtained in this direction, there are some controllability results. I will not write any equations. I mean, that's just a historical thing. And different people were involved in this. This is, I believe, not a complete list. In particular, the recent contributions were done by colleagues who are here from PDE. So the initial, so to say, push was done by control people specialized in nonlinear control and geometric control. And then there was a lot of contribution of Armen Shirikyan and Wagner Sessian, who resolved plenty of analytic problems. So let me say now some general things before I pass to ensembles of systems, which is a different, completely different situation. This I say for young people. So I mean, let me say there are still plenty of open problems. I mean, there are two type of difficulties when you seek to apply Lie algebraic method to infinite dimensional situation, in particular to nonlinear PDE. The first type of difficulties are analytic, because you have nonlinear partial differential equations, for example, with something at the right-hand side, which is of the following, something like something of this type, for example. So you have something which is, so to say, high gain. It has high amplitude and it has fast oscillation. So and you need some non-canonical, non-standard, non-classical continuity results for this type of non-linear differential equation. That is the first difficulty in non-linear PDE. It was kind of a new situation which has been treated. And the second, and certainly plenty of difficulties, standard difficulties with boundary conditions, et cetera, et cetera. So that has been resolved. That's the great contribution has been made by Armen and Wagner. But the second difficulty, and this difficulty is not yet resolved satisfactorily, that's the second difficulty is difficulty of Lie algebraic type. So I mean, you have to, for example, if you deal with Navier-Stokes equation on a domain, then you have to study algebra of, so you have some spectral geometry of this domain, and you have to study an algebra of eigenfunctions of the Laplacian on this domain. That's essentially what you deal with, at least in 2D case, in two-dimensional Navier-Stokes equation. Then this is completely not studied. So there were some progresses in periodic case on torus. There were some progresses for spheres, hemisphere. But as, for example, I can say to young people that the problem on the disk is an open problem. It's an open problem. That the problem on the disk, as far as I know, if my colleagues do not correct me, is open. I mean, you cannot. There is no controllability result for the two-dimensional disk. And the main difficulty is that you have here with the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian in this case, which are defined by Bessel by means of Bessel function, and you have a very complicated algebra of this Bessel function. And there is plenty of things to do. So I address it mainly to young people. There is a lot of interesting algebra in it, I mean, to study algebra and symplectic geometry and a lot of these things. So that was a historical part. I believe I'm done with this, so I can come to something, to some concrete things. So we will consider another type of infinite dimensional system. Now forget PDE, it was just a historic, and now we pass to another type of infinite dimensional system, which is also rather well known, and there are quite many publications on it. I will, in few slides, I will explain the origin of this. So what is an ensemble of systems? That's essentially a family, a parameterized family of control systems. So theta is a parameter here, and so the solution is, as far as theta enters the right-hand side, the solution depends on theta. So we have a dynamics in infinite dimensional space of the functions of the parameter theta. So theta here is an arbitrary compact subset of Rd. So if theta is trivial, so it is a singleton, we have a one system, so it's a standard control theory. So interesting cases when it is not a singleton, it can be finite or infinite. And so the origin of the problem setting comes probably, I mean, as far as I know, comes from experiments in NMR, the famous Bloch system. When you have some dispersion, so it's all about system with indeterminacy. Yes, with a system which has some undetermined parameterized indeterminacy. Yeah. So I believe the starting model it all started in the beginning of 2000, and as far as I know, the first publications were due to Haneja and Li. And it was related to so-called Bloch equation. That's I just give for information. That's a very rather simply looking equation on SO3. And this simply looking equation contained parameters omega and theta, and both are subject to some dispersion. Yeah? So they are not defined exactly. So they belong to some intervals, and we want to simultaneously control it, for example, from point to point. So what means that you do not know a priori the value of parameter, but you still want to control, to invent some control which is independent on parameters, and to transfer a system from point to a point independently on parameters. So that's the idea. See, approximately, you cannot do it exactly, but approximately you want to do this. So that was the so to say, the first model of interest and the first attempt to apply also algebraic methods, since we are on a Lie group. So it was natural to apply Lie algebraic approach to this. In the case of Haneja et Lie, it was just Campbell-Hausdorff formula or something, some tools of this kind. Later on, there was a much more extensive work on this done by Karine Bouchard, Jean-Michel Coron, and Pierre Rochon on this, more extensive, where the problem was kind of settled, at least, well, we may say it was settled in this work. So now we come to a different situation, to a general situation. So it was an example of what is interesting in these kind of models, and we come to a general situation. So again, we consider this family of nonlinear control system, and we also allow the parameter in the initial condition. So moreover, today I will speak about this second case when the parameter is, so we will have, in a few slides, we will have a control system which is not depending on parameter, and we wish to transform some parameterized family, for example. So to say, so the main setting today will be, we wish to do the following thing. So we have an initial curve, yes, and we have a target curve, and we have one control system of the following type, and our objective is to find a control which transforms this initial curve to a neighborhood and one or another metric, if you wish, integral metric or C0 metric, in the neighborhood of this. So we want to find a control such that the respective flow corresponding to this control system and to this control transforms the initial curve into a finite curve which is close in some metric to the target curve. That's the idea. There is an obvious generalization of this. We may speak about control of diffeomorphisms, so we may just wish to control the flow. We might just consider the flow in the group of diffeomorphisms. And during the talk, I will provide some results on this. So that's the problem setting I will consider. So for a moment, the general setting can be done when we have also a parameter. The system are dependent on the parameter, but later on we concentrate on the second case. So the standard thing, so we assume that we are on some manifold, connected manifold, Riemannian manifold with some Riemannian distance. So what we call ensemble? Ensemble will be called just an image of continuous map from the set of parameters theta to this manifold. We consider theta to be compact. It's Lebesgue measure set if we want to define a L1 or L2 measure. So and we denote it by E theta. E theta of M is the space of parameters. And it is obviously infinite dimensional if theta is an infinite set. Yes, if it is a finite set, it is finite dimensional. Then in general, it is an infinite dimensional space of curves, for example. Or it can be surfaces, et cetera, et cetera. So it's we wish to control something like this. Yes, and so what I said, we wish to control, to define a control dynamics. So the control dynamics is, I said it already, but essentially this is the following thing. So if we add here a parameter theta, yes, then the flow generated by this family of systems is also depends on the parameter theta. So we have a flow which depends on the control and parameter theta, and it depends on time t. And we apply this flow to an initial ensemble alpha of theta, which are the initial conditions, say. Oh, gamma of theta is here, there, yes, okay, gamma of theta. Gamma of theta, and then we get a result. So that's our controlled evolution. So for each control, we have a curve in the space of ensembles. For example, curve in the space of curves or surfaces, yeah, kind of homotopy. So that's the controlled dynamics in the space of ensembles. And we set controllability problem for the action, for this action. And we can speak about exact controllability. So that's when you can transform an ensemble, an initial ensemble, into a finite ensemble exactly. So this is, I would say, is available only in the case of finite ensembles. In finite ensembles, we can achieve exact controllability. I trust it can be done a theorem, so that in infinite case you cannot do this by the methods like Bolz lemma or the non-controllability result. This can be done. In the case when the number of parameters in infinite, you cannot. Generally, cannot do this. We can define the attainable set from the ensemble. Yeah, so it's again will be a subset of the space of ensembles. And again, well, a banal remark that if the ensemble is trivial, so we deal with singletons, the whole story coincides with the respective terminology for single control systems. But as I said, yes? Continuously, huh? Yes, yes, ensemble is continuous in theta. No, control is theta independent, that's important. Control is, yes, that's extremely important. Yeah, control, that's the whole point of the thing. No, it's f of theta continues, yes. F of theta continues, but control is theta independent. That's the whole point, yes. So we wish to find a theta independent control which kind of transforms the whole curve into a curve. We do not know the theta. Yeah. The whole family. You have a dispersion in parameters and you wish to control independently of the dispersion. Yes, control is always independent on theta, yes. Yes. Yeah, but after I mean that in a sense it's more interesting situation. Well, it's less general probably. We will take F independent on theta. We will wish just to control curves and surfaces, so to say. That's the point. And we come to the notion of approximate controllability, which is, I would say, the only one available in the case of infinite or continual, we call it continual ensembles. So we cannot expect their exact controllability, so we introduce an obvious notion of C0 or LP approximate controllability, so in integral norm, so that's the first definition is steerability, I would say, that we can steer an ensemble to ensemble. Sorry, I forgot here should be theta also, virgula theta, I mean, I because we are still in general setting. And that's a definition of approximate controllability in C0 norm. This is definition of approximate steerability or controllability in integral norm of LP. So when I speak about C0 and LP, I speak about C0 of theta, yes, of theta capital, the set of parameter, and LP of theta capital. So that's our definition. And we will distinguish two cases. So it's for us it will be convenient to distinguish two cases. So the cases, so that's a little bit delicate. I mean, we distinguish the cases when our control, well, the most general cases when we have dependence on theta in system and in initial condition, yes? That's the first case. Or we can consider a particular problem when there is dependence only in theta, so we have a dispersion on parameter, but we wish to steer point to point. So the robust control, so to say, the control which does not depend on parameter and steers the whole family of system to the needed situation. That's the first case. About this, we developed some, say, algebraic approach. It has been published 3 years ago in a paper mentioned there. Kind of general algebraic approach to some problems of this type. But today I wish to concentrate, it will be convenient because the formulations are different. The formulations are different and it will be convenient to consider the second case, so what I mentioned in the beginning. So from now on we will have the system which does not depend on control, on parameter, the initial condition depends on parameter, and we wish to approximately transfer the initial curve to the neighborhood of the target final curve. Yeah, so we wish to find this control. So the more general problem setting will be to control on the group of diffeomorphism. Yes, so we wish to find the control which transforms a diffeomorphism initial, say, identity diffeomorphism to a neighborhood of a given diffeomorphism, yes? Okay, then that's, I believe that's, I would like to emphasize that we have a limited, very limited control. So our control is only a function of T. We do not allow anything else. So it's a very, very, very poor class of control. So that's our problem setting. So I will concentrate today on this second type of controllability. Seems to me it's rather beautiful from geometric viewpoint. So we control surfaces, curves, and such objects, by controls which are independent of the parameter on this surface, And so we can define this. So first I define, I will explain this. It's very easy that these ensembles can be given a structure of Banach manifold in an obvious way. So we consider just a continuous function. So imagine that M is Rn, for example. So we can consider continuous functions defined on theta Rn valued. For example, in the case of finite ensemble, it's just a Cartesian product of n copies of M. So we can define, since M is a smooth manifold, we can define the tangent space on this space of the ensembles. That's a formal definition. So that's a coordinatization of the tangent element of this tangent space. So it's a very nice Banach manifold. So in the case of finite ensemble, that's enough for us, and we get exact controllability results easily in this case. So there is no problem about it. The problem comes in infinite dimensional case, because the algebraic approach is not completely adapted to this case. And as we will see, this structure of Banach manifold does not help much. I mean, we have to do it to study it, we cannot act with standard general results for Banach manifolds. That it's often the case, So it's infinite dimensional systems are not part of theory of general nonlinear maps in infinite dimensional spaces. We will see it later, and that's important. We did not say so. With the same way as we have defined the tangent space on the Banach manifold ensemble, we can define vector fields on the ensembles. And moreover, that's important for us, that if we have a vector field on M, this can be lifted to a vector field on the space of ensemble by obvious thing that you can act on ensemble differentiated by T, and then you get a vector field. And the vector field is very easy, as easily as just F calculated along the ensemble. I mean, that's a very easy computation. And also you can define the Lie brackets of this vector fields, of this lifted vector field. So the whole story looks simple in the sense of definition, but not in the sense of results, as we will see in a moment. So such properties like bracket generating, et cetera, are not at all simple here. So that's the whole nice story, the whole nice picture, which we will not use very much later for the reasons which are explained. So again, I mean, I repeat the definition of approximate controllability. So I will concentrate today on C0 approximate controllability. For example, it's more natural here. So we wish we have a control system, and we wish to find a control independent on parameter. And we have, initial and target ensembles parameterized by theta, and we wish to find a theta independent control which transforms alpha in C0 close in an ensemble which is C0 close to omega. So that's our problem setting. We start with elementary case of controllability, which is a finite ensemble. That's an easy case, because here everything is can be everything can be done by standard Hrushevsky-Chou result, because in finite case, our manifold is just nth degree, so we take n capital copies of M, we take a Cartesian product, so we consider n uples of points of M, so they belong to Mn, and here in this case it is convenient for us to consider injective ensembles, so they are different. We assume them to be different, so that's a case of n-uples which are pairwise different in coordinates. And so we wish to consider a control system. And control system, we have a control system on M. This is control system on M. And obviously this control system can be lifted to the m to the power of n. And we put a problem of global controllability of this system. Well, no, let us consider something so we wish by simultaneous control. So that's the problem. We have n points, and we, by a unique control, we wish to transform it in n points. So for geometric control people, it's a very obvious problem, not always obvious for, I have heard from people, say, from mathematical physics, many questions. Is it possible to start with different initial condition and transform it to some other final terminal condition? So for control, for geometric control people, it's a rather obvious thing that it's not very, very different from the case of one system. So let us consider a, say, simple case. I mean, obviously, if we have difficulty in establishing controllability on M, certainly it's even more difficult to establish controllability on the nth power of M, so we consider something simple, so we consider a control linear system of this kind. So essentially, so we have this, and then controllability can be treated by standard Hrushevsky-Chou theorem. Well, the only point is that here we have very particular vector fields. So their particular vector fields are n-uples of identical, of the same vector field, repetition of the same vector field. So our dynamic is very degenerate, yes? So we have a vector field of this kind FFF, of the same vector field repeated, yes? So x1, et cetera, xn are guided by the same system. The initial conditions are different, but the system is the same. So we have a very limited controllability situation, but the question can be answered. So we obviously can define Li brackets in this way, so we take it component-wise and repeat it n times. So we can define a control system on this manifold on m to the power of m, and the result is obvious. We can define a bracket-generating condition or Hermander condition, so on the power of nth fold of m, so to say. So we can evaluate the iterated Li brackets, and that's important thing, that if we have this property of bracket generating of n folds, what are n folds of vector field? N folds of vector fields are these vector fields. So, and we bracket them component-wise. Yes, certainly, and if this if these n folds are bracket generated on this big manifold, then we have by Hrushevsky-Chou theorem, there is nothing new, by Hrushevsky-Chou theorem, we have a controllability. An important remark is that if n is the number of elements in the ensemble is greater than one, this property is obviously strictly stronger than the standard bracket generating property on M. For example, if these vector fields generate nilpotent or finite dimensional algebra, then there is no controllability of sufficiently big ensembles. So obviously there is an obvious relation between the dimensions. Maybe I wrote it, but it's an obvious relation. So you cannot control big ensembles if the algebra is finite dimensional, in particular nilpotent, yes? So that's important. And then this is a proposition. I repeat that from control theoretical viewpoint, there is nothing new here. That's just Reshevsky-Chow theorem applied to the n-fold of the manifold M. We were looking for an interesting result, which is known in control theory, the first result of nonlinear control theory. It was a result by Lobry, who was saying that if we have a system of this kind, then the controllability property for this system is generic. That there is an open dense residual set with respect to some metric C of sufficient high order, such that any R-ruple, or how you say, of these vector fields from this set is controllable. That's a result of Lobry from 70s. So we wish to get the similar result for the ensembles, for finite ensembles, and we managed to do this. That's not a repetition, unlike the previous result, that's not a repetition of standard Reshevsky-Chow, because here it is written. So when we speak about genericity means here that we allow to perturb this vector field, but not the whole story. We cannot perturb them independently, yes? So that's a different problem setting than the classical Lobry result. Yes, we have much more limited possibility of the perturbation of vector fields. And still we managed to prove that theorem, that in this case for the ensembles, so the set of the bracket generating property for the set of n folds is generic, is verified for a generic a ruple of vector fields. So we have our control linear system. So the proof of Lobry goes by at the end goes it requires some rectification arguments or rectification of one vector field, and then at the end applies Tom transversality theorem to get genericity. So in this case we have to employ something a little bit more delicate, which is John Mazur's multijet transversality theorem, because we have here vector fields computed in different points of the manifold. So we have to involve here multijets and to use this result of Mazur. Okay, and now we come to more interesting. The finite ensemble is intuitively clear case. So now we come to continual ensembles and motion planning. The formulation will be a little bit, particular. So we talk not about controllability, but more about control along something, or it is called also motion planning. Again, for simplicity, we consider the symmetric control system, control linear of this kind. So what we do? We consider a finite and initial and finite and target ensemble of points. So we consider two ensembles of points, and we consider some diffeotopy which joins these, say, two curves, for example. This diffeotopy is generated by some flow, what we call diffeotopy, is generated by some flow, by some equation. By by some equation of this kind, and y is, say, c1 and y is small and continuous in t. I mean, important that this y capital is not related to control system, obviously, because otherwise everything is trivial if we can transform it, the ensemble in ensemble. So y is just a vector field, not having to do anything with control system. So we take just two diffeotopic ensembles. Yes, and we wish to. It's written here, yes. Yes, well, in alternative, we can consider something which is, so to speak, approximately diffeotopic, but okay, it's not probably very, very important. So we can find, well, okay, that's not extremely important. And yes, that's what I said. That's important, that the flow which transforms this initial ensemble into finite ensemble has nothing to do with the control system. So it's absolutely nothing to do because otherwise the problem is trivial. And so what we wish? We wish now we have some diffeotopy and we wish now to find the control. So now we come back to our control system. And we wish to find the control which transforms this to the neighborhood of this. We will do it in such a way that we will remain close to diffeotopy, so to say, that I'm talking about them, and then, yeah, so that's the problem setting. And we seek for control which transform the initial ensemble to the finite ensemble. Certainly, we need something like bracket generating, yes, bracket generating condition in this situation. And we call this condition, the analog of this condition is bracket approximating condition along the diffeotopy. I will later explain because why we have introduced a diffeotopy, et cetera. That's a little bit delicate story. So we introduce this condition, which is called bracket approximating condition. And that's the following conditions. So we need some notation. So that's, we consider the, so we have our system is so this is our control system. This is our control system. So we consider the Lie algebra, Lie envelope of this control system. So we take this the vector fields from which are Lie brackets, iterated Lie brackets of this, and then we take a subset because we take a subset of this Lie algebra of the vector fields which are Lipschitzian with some constant lambda. So we take something bounded in the Lipschitzian metric, yes? So we have a bounded Lipschitzian constant, yes? On some neighborhood of this, on some neighborhood of the diffeotopy. And now we introduce an assumption which looks a little bit at cumbersome, but I will later explain that there is in a sense natural. So our assumption C0 Lie bracket C0 approximating condition is the following. That if we take the vector field Y, which generates our diffeotopy, then this vector field evaluated along the elements of the diffeotopy. Yes, so we have here a foliation of this diffeotopy by the curves, by the image of the curves under the diffeotopy. So the evaluation along this diffeotopy differ from the evaluation from, can be approximated by the vector fields from the Lie algebra of F, and also with this restriction on the Lipschitz constant gamma. This looks rather cumbersome and a little bit ugly in comparison with nice bracket generating condition, but in a few minutes I will explain why this is needed. I mean, that's our main analog of bracket generating conditions. So Lie bracket C0, yes, and this is done uniformly in theta for theta belonging to theta and for each t belonging to t. So this is our condition. So we manage to approximate this vector field by elements of the Lie algebra under controlling the Lipschitz constant of these elements. And then, yes, there is another technical assumption. That's the first one is very essential. Second is more technical. So we assume these fields to be C0 smooth in order to calculate a lot of Lie brackets. And we assume them to be bounded on the whole manifold M. If M is complex, it's all okay, it's not needed. Are bounded on the whole M and together with their covariant derivatives of each order. Yeah? So imagine, for example, some of these vector fields, if we are on non-compact manifold, these vector fields, say, multiplied by some rapidly decreasing function. And then, this is related to the second condition is related to the question of completeness, etc. And then we get a theorem, which says that if these two conditions are satisfied for the diffeotopy, then the initial ensemble of the diffeotopy, this alpha of theta, can be steered to the neighborhood of the finite ensemble. I mean, I will not give a proof. I mean, but anticipating the proof, which you can find in a preprint in archive. I mean, you can imagine that the whole evolution, controlled evolution, of this ensemble will go in the neighborhood of this diffeotopy. So it's kind of. So this diffeotopy is important. I mean, the result looks a little bit partial. I mean, what are the alternatives? I mean, let me. I believe I do not have much time. So that's something about the proof, which says, let me be quicker a little bit, because I want to spend some time with discussing the formulation. Discussing the formulation is more interesting here than the proof. So essentially, there's a standard technique extension. So we consider an extended control system where these vector fields are the Lie brackets of the initial vector fields. And then we have to approximate the flow generated by the extended system by the flow of the original system. So for people from geometric control is known. And the third result, I forgot to say, the third result which I would like to mention, the whole story, I will not comment much on it. I mean, the whole story that we can also make a formulation, and probably this is more a nicer formulation for the group of diffeomorphism. So essentially, this result says the following. If we have a flow generated by extended control system, so this is probably more comprehensible yet. By this control system where the vector fields X are Lie brackets of the system, then this diffeomorphism can be approximated by a diffeomorphism generated by the original control system. So we have an approximate controllability in the group of diffeomorphism, a little bit reduced approximate controllability, I mean. Because this is extended control system, this is original control system, so there is a relation between the system. But still we have a result on approximate controllability. Okay, but let me so this is a corollary for ensembles. In the last 10 minutes I have, there is an example, I mean, an example in R2, a simple example in R2, where I explain how we can verify this approximating condition. But let me pass, since I have only, this is a computation of all Lie brackets, so in the whole story reduces to the density of the space of Hermite, of the system of Hermite polynomials in this example. But let me discuss the formulation, because the first formulation we were not. I mean, why this formulation is a little bit peculiar. So why we need to involve diffeotopy, etc. So let me discuss something. I mean, so we have this is a standard Rashevsky-Chow theorem in finite dimension. There is no need. Everybody knows this from the lectures of Professor Agarachov, etc. So this is standard Rashevsky-Chow theorem in finite dimension. There are results which generalize the Rashevsky-Chow theorem with bracket generating condition to infinite dimension, to Banach manifolds. The first of such results was in 1980, so some two Ukrainian Soviet mathematicians published this result in 1980 or 1981, the generalization of Rashevsky-Chow to the infinite dimensional case. I mean, the generalization is rather obvious. They act on a Banach manifold, and we have a Banach manifold. They take Lie brackets of the vector fields, and they say that if the closure of the value of the elements of the Lie algebra at each point coincide with the whole tangent space of the Banach manifold, then the system is globally approximately controllable, obviously, because we take a closure, then we get only approximate controllability. Yes, so that's a natural result. It seems very, very, very nice. Unfortunately, this result does not work in reasonable situations. I mean, it definitely does not work in PDE, because PDE involve unbounded operators, and in this case, they ask this everything be smooth, differentiable, continuously differential, so it will never work to PDE does not. To PDE does not. No. For formal PDE, but what you call approximately? What you call approximately for a formal case. Okay, but I mean, that's surprising. I mean, that it does not work for PDE, it was clear. But surprisingly, it does not even work in our case, which is very natural. I mean, just computation of vector field along curves. For two reasons. The first reason is practical, so to say, practical. Because, I mean, look, what this theorem asks, they ask verification of this condition at each point of a huge Banach manifold. So in our case, such kind of condition will require verification along any curve, say curve, if we are one dimensional, any curve in the space, I mean, which is absolutely, I mean, unreasonable to do. That's the one reason for the less important reason for taking the diffeotopy, et cetera, because here, when we verify our condition along the diffeotopy, is a condition which should be verified along one parametric family of curves, in this case of curves, yes? So it's much more economic, but it's a less important reason. The second important reason that this condition is extremely unstable structurally, so it will be violated. It does not hold, it's not stable even locally. It is not stable even locally. I mean, I explained that we can even for single system we can find a version the longer diffeotopy for single system, but it's not important. I mean, that's the main reason that this condition that condition on this general infinite dimensional Rashevsky-Chow theorem in our example may fail. Or often fails, rather even locally. That's a simple example. If we have a continual ensemble, obviously not for finite ensembles, everything is okay. For infinite ensembles, for example, we can take if we have a curve, so we can reparameterize. So in any neighborhood in C0 of this ensemble, we can find an ensemble which is constant on some set of parameters, of some non-trivial set of parameters. So we can reparameterize it at some point. We stay at a point. Yes, it's constant. So we reparameterize in such way that we have a trivial piece. parameter reduced to a point. And it is obvious, it's easy to check that in this case, the bracket generating condition just will not, in their sense, will not hold. It will not be bracket generating in the sense of the theorem I have just demonstrated. If we have a constant piece, it's easy to check that you cannot approximate any vector field. It's a degeneracy. That's only one type of degeneracy, but you can invent many types of such degeneracies. When you get this density, I mean the k condition of this theorem is density of this thing. And if you have a degenerate piece, you will never be dense there. And there are other types of degeneracies. So I mean the key point of our reasoning that you may get approximating condition on the diffeotopy and not have it nearby, the approximately close to this diffeotopy. So that's why we need such a kind of, to be a little bit heavy in the formulations to involve this diffeotopy, et cetera. We are not able here to formulate such general result like in finite dimensional case because this condition is just very, very, very unstable, so to say. No, I believe it's better, yeah, there, what is else? Yeah, I mean, here there is an example which probably I will not do it. I mean, there is an example, if you remember, there was another condition on boundedness of Lipschitz constant, and here I explain why this condition is important even in the case of one system. I mean, there is a rather easy example, but you can find it in a preprint. So the preprint is in archive in this year, Agrachov-Sarachev, and you can see there this example. I mean, it's an easy example which explains that that even for one system, you can invent an example when you need some bounds for Lipschitz constant. Okay, I believe I finish here. Thank you.